The Unsung War Casualties, Chapter 3. In the later part of January 1945, we were starting on a death march back from the Oder River and Stalag 12B towards Berlin. It was cold, 5 degrees to about 15 degrees at night, and sometimes a bit warmer or colder in the daytime. Our direction of march was to the west and slightly south, as the Jerrys, the Germans, tried to keep us off of their direct military support roads. This was fortunate, in a way, as we passed through many farms where we could scrounge for horse turnips or even grass. We did this when the guards would permit us to dart out of the line now and then to dig into the buried mounds of turnips for anything edible, and then dash back into the column ahead of the outriders while dodging their bullets. Another picture of the march, this one in the snow. Take a look at this. Again, one of the harshest winters on record in Germany ever was in 1945. You can see this photo of the death march, all the prisoners lined up, extending all the way around here, going all the way up to the top. The snow, obviously feet of snow on the ground. So an extraordinary photograph there of different sections of the death march that Sachs and Sully and Wright and Rapetti may have been on. The Jerrys gave us no food during the entire march, which lasted to early February in its first phase. The Germans didn't feed prisoners during marches. Many of our number just gave up and starved, froze to death, or became too weak and fell to the ground as the column passed on around them. Some still had unhealed wounds that brought them down. All who fell from the ranks were shot by a squad of guards following at the rear of the column. We could hear the gunfire constantly coming from the rear of our procession. This caused us to expend every bit of strength we had to try to keep up. Now and then, we could hear the thump of German trucks plowing into the stragglers at the rear as they hurled bodies this way and that. No one was left alive. Bernie and I stayed close together and helped each other to keep up. We shared anything edible that we were able to scrounge from the roadside. Wright and Rapetti made it a foursome, and we all tried to watch out for each other. In the military, we usually gave each other nicknames, which were often a contraction or a short version of our last names. Rapetti was Rep. I called your dad Sully for Southerton most of the time. I was Sachs, and Wright was just Wright, as we didn't figure out how to shorten that name. So, if I use those names occasionally, you will know to whom I am referring. Your dad and I had, through our industry and trading, collected about 18 or 20 packs of cigarettes during our stay at Stalag 12B. Cigarettes were the same as money while in camp. D-bars were a secondary medium of exchange, but worth much less. It was here that we learned our first bitter lesson in finance. On the road, everyone wanted D-bars, as there wasn't any soup ration. So D-bars became priceless and cigarettes about worthless during the march. We tried to trade smokes, in which we were invested totally, for the D-bars, and found our small fortune was worthless. So Sully and I, neither one of us smoked, opened a pack of cigarettes and puffed away till they were too hard to deal with. and we both added coughing and choking to our other miseries. The march continued day and night without stopping, except for twice during the month and a half that we were walking back toward Berlin. On these stops, the Germans would head us into a barn, for instance, and not break it off until the barn was full and exploding from the force of the men being prodded inside. Often, men in the deepest part of the barn were pushed right out through the walls by the pressure. These prisoners were brought around to the front and forced back into the barn. At one of these stops, two only in all that time, I was pushed out through the back wall of the barn onto a manure pile and was grabbed by the guards and reintroduced to the barn through the front doors. The Jerrys didn't seem to have any sense of how many prisoners could crowd into the space available. Consequently, when the doors were finally shut and the column diverted elsewhere, we were left standing and packed like sardines, and there was no way to lie down or even sit. A number of prisoners were crushed or smothered to death. If one somehow fell to the floor, there was no way to get up again as the push of bodies closed off his space. Men climbed up onto the beams of the framework of the barn to escape the crush below. Sometimes they crowded the beams so hard that some fell off into the mob below. During the night, those up in the rafters urinated and defecated into the crowd below. The whole scene was terrifying, and there was no rest. The living were delighted to get out of the barn in the morning and back on the road. It was impossible to tell what towns we passed through, as the Jerrys had removed all the road signs. But it seemed that we were going slightly south and mostly west. I think we may have crossed the Czech border at times, and then we moved northwest toward Berlin. We were walking on severely frozen feet, and even our hands and faces were badly frostbitten. I noticed bright red stripes growing up the inside of my legs from my shoe tops to the groin. Blood poisoning was setting in, and there was nothing that I could do to stop it. So I vowed not to look at it again. In the back of my mind, I felt that soon I might meet my fate at the end of the column with the execution squads. I felt sad that I didn't know where I was exactly, and that my family would never know where I had perished. But we cheered each other and kept on. Various vehicles, trucks, horse-drawn wagons, and tractor-drawn wagons passed us constantly on the left edge of the road. One day, as we stumbled along, starving and frozen almost to death, I looked up, and there was a tractor-drawn wagon passing. It was loaded with supplies for the guards, and a guard was sitting in the middle of a pile of supplies on the wagon. I should say here that we, the prisoners, were now walking with our heads bent down, out of the wind, and our eyes on the road, because to stumble and fall might be fatal if we couldn't get up. But I happened to look up as this tractor passed, and my eyes locked with those of the guard in the wagon. He was staring directly at me, and he had a number 10 can in his hand. I don't know why, but our eyes met, and we were locked together for a long moment. Then he launched the can directly at me. Out of all those prisoners, it sailed high
and came down directly over my head. I launched myself into the air as hard as I could and took the can into both hands, bringing it down inside my check jacket and hiding it as well as I could. I had no idea what was in the can, but it felt heavy, and I felt we, the four of us, had a treasure. The wagon and guard passed out of sight, but we never lost eye contact, and I held up a hand in thanks to him, though I had no idea what we had received. When things settled down, I took a look and found that it was a can of cheese that had spoiled and burst open. We couldn't care less about the spoilage. The four of us took turns digging into the soft green stuff with our fingers and gulped it down as fast as we could. Soon the cheese was gone, and the can was wiped clean twice over and then discarded. But we had a little more strength to go a few more miles. Our guards were mostly old men, 60 years old or more. They walked beside us at each end of our rank and traded off with relief guards riding in wagons twice daily so they could eat and rest. Despite the fact that they could rest and had food, many of them were not much better than we were. Their age and our youth brought us to similar conditions, though there was a great difference in sustenance between us. With each change and shift of the guards, the same guards would find our group rank, and there arose a certain familiarity between us, despite the fact that we were enemies. I guess they may have shot us if we had tried to run, but still, we were suffering many of the same discomforts, and we were bound to have some things in common. And that concludes chapter 3.